Уважаеми господин ректор, уважаема госпожо декан, скъпи гости и колеги, за мен е голяма чест, че имам възможността да представя пред вас професор Марк Гелер, който днес предстои да бъде удостоен с нашето най-високо академично отличие. Почетното звание доктор хонорис кауза на Софийския университет. Както повечето от вас добре знаят, професор Гелер е учен с висока международна репутация, един от най-добрите специалисти в света в областта на хебраистиката и изследването на езиците и културите на древна Месопотамия. Марк Гелер е роден през 1940 година в Корпус Кристи, Съединените щати, в семейство на еврейски преселници от Европа. Баща му е седмият от поредица потомствени равини, живели в граничните области между Полша и Русия. През 1970 година Марк Гелер получава бакалавърска степен по класически езици в Принстън, а през 1972 година защитава магистратура по семитски езици, която след това прераства в докторат, защитен през 1974 година в университета Брандейс, Масачузетс. Дисертацията му е на тема «Арамейските магически чаши и отношението им към равинистичните текстове». Академичната кариера на професор Марк Гелер е свързана предимно с Европа. Той започва преподавателската си дейност в департамента по хебраистика в University College London. През 1983 година става директор на Института по хебраистика в същия университет, а от 1983 до 1994 година е ръководител на департамента по иврит и хебристика в University College London. Редовен професор от 1991 година в University College London, също така гост професор в Свободния университет в Берлин в периода от 2000 до 2018 година. Професор Марк Гелер е участник и организатор на множество значими международни научни проекти. През 2008 година той става член на екипа на Excellence Cluster Topoi, създаден по съвместен проект на Свободния университет в Берлин и Академията Макс Планк, с цел изследване на човешкото познание от дълбоката древност до късното средновековие. Клъстърът събира изследователи и хуманитаристи с различен профил, сред които преподаватели и специализанти и от България. Именно като част от екипа на Topoi, професор Гелер разработва и ръководи най-новия си голям проект, посветен на медицински знания в Древен Вавилон и преноса на тези знания в късната античност. Професор Гелер е един от най-големите специалисти в света по клинопис и културата на Асирия и Вавилон, за което свидетелстват многобройните му публикации с разчетени клинописни таблици и надписи. Научните му интереси и постижения са свързани най-вече с развитието на познанието в древния свят, връзката между магията и науката, трансфера на знания от Месопотамия към Древна Гърция и Рим. Автор е на 9 монографии, първата от които за шумерските заклинания и на над 130 научни публикации. В рамките на своя проект в Topoi, професор Гелер организира огромен брой публични семинари с лектори от цял свят по проблематиката на медицинското познание, далечното минало и преноса на тези знания към новите времена. Благодарение на усилията на професор Гелер, както и на съпругата му Флорентина Бадаланова Гелер, славистичната и българистичната проблематика бяха също включени в обсега на изследователския клъстър, като се откриха неочаквани връзки между нашето средновековие и Древния изток. В края на миналата година, по покана на катедрата по стара история, теология и средновековна история към историческия факултет, професор Гелер изнесе в Софийския университет лекция за краха на политеизма, която беше посрещната с огромен интерес от преподавателите и студентите на Софийския университет. Сигурен съм, че също толкова интересни неща ще чуем от професор Гелер и днес. Научните интереси на професор Гелер могат да бъдат обобщени така – медицина, магия, знание. В областта на знанието, също и на медицината, Софийският университет има своите достижения и традиции. Надявам се, професор Гелер да ни помогне и с магията, защото доста неща има за подобряване в университета, а бюджета винаги не стига. Сега давам думата на ректора на Софийския университет, професор Анастас Гирджиков.
Висше училище Възряци, наречено е именем Присно Блажена Его, Учителя Блъгарска Его, Климента Охридска Его, повядава Въсе Хондошство, Любословна Его и Историческа Его учение, еже съвършила еста професор Марк Гелер, съчъстиум глашаята Его, Пасано почета на Его доктора Въйше Его училища Климента Охридска Его. Възряци, мясънца декембря, седма Его на десенте, валято седмата и сонщно е, и пентасътно е, и девадесентно е, и осмо е, ота сътворения миро. Универзитас литерарум сърдицензис, номине санкти клементи сахридензис, ексентенция факултатис филологиарум славикарум, вирум еминентисимум адкве реверендисимум, професорем докторем Марк Гелер, докторем хонорис кауза сиенциарум филологикарум университатис сърдицензис, номинавит адкве декларавит. И на юскве рей фидем хок диплома сигилу майоре университатис роборатум, ет консветис субскрипционибус монитум, ей дандум корабит. Датум сердице, анте дием секстум, децимум, календас януариас, анно домини, бис милезимо, девицезимо.
За мен е чест да аз съм тук днес. Лага нощ, благодаря на моите много приятели, колеги от София университет. And now, English. I hope there is a translation of my talk for those of you who find English difficult. Ivo has... Okay, yes. There's a paper here, if you need it. So, have any of you experienced a solar eclipse? Or maybe I should ask, maybe someone hasn't experienced a solar eclipse. We had one in London a number of years ago, and it was an eerie and strange event. The sky becomes dark, midday, birds stop singing, dogs bark. Even in our age of science, one feels as if nature is sending an ominous message. But imagine what the reaction to an eclipse would be in the ancient world, in which people were sensitive to signs and omens thought to be messages from gods, warning them about floods and fires and drought and disease, and storms, and of course, human enemies. But for the ancient world, eclipses meant bad news, and especially for the king and the ruling powers. For example, a lunar eclipse in the year 671 BCE greatly alarmed the Assyrian king Assarhaddon, who suffered from chronic poor health, but also conspiracies against him during his 12-year reign. Now, as a response to this lunar eclipse, Esarhaddon invoked this Sumerian king ritual. So the king, now called the farmer, withdraws from his throne and moves from his palace into a small private house. A substitute king and queen would be put on his throne, dressed in royal clothes and symbols of power. Now, just imagine the Tsar of Russia having to move into a small dacha while some mujik takes his place in the winter palace. This was the scale of this event. Huh? But since the eclipse would predict that something bad would happen to the king at the end of this period of a few months, the substitute king and his spouse were executed. So this confirms the bad omen. But as far as we can tell from historical records, Esarhaddon was the last Assyrian or Babylonian king to use this drastic substitute king ritual. And the reason for this, because of advances in science. So even during Esarhaddon's reign, his army of scholars and astronomers were hard at work taking observations about the movements of the stars and making predictions about when eclipses might take place. Now, although accurate predictions would still require several more centuries, but by the middle of the first century BCE, Babylonian scholars had made enormous progress in mathematics of astronomical calculations. The results that once scholars could predict an eclipse, the omens become less ominous. If you know mathematically when the eclipse will occur, this removes the element of surprise. Once an eclipse is seen as a regular celestial occurrence, then it loses much of its sense of danger. But this poses a challenge to religion. The progress in astronomy altered the views of the cosmos, which profoundly affected religion. So the Babylonians previously had the idea that the cosmos was guided by the gods, especially Ea, the god of wisdom. So Ea had a drawing of the heavens known as his Utsurtu, which determined how and when the stars would move. Now the Bible believes in something similar. We can see from Amos, it says, God is creator of Orion and the Pleiades. He exchanges the shadows of the morning and darkens the daylight into the night. Huh? This is important. Gospode inatomu. But once these Syrian and Babylonian scholars begin to view the heavens as a kind of clockwork, which moves according to its own rules and laws, which can predict everything mathematically, this changes everything. Theology now has to adapt itself to a new vision of the heavens, which was no longer guided by gods, but by science. But this wasn't all bad news for religion, since the interest in heaven above replaced the underworld as the source of higher knowledge. So instead of going down to the netherworld, like Gilgamesh or Homer's Aeneas, visionary figures like Enoch were traveling to the seven heavens above to discover the secrets of the cosmos, including astronomy. So the significant change is chronicled in the Slavonic secret books of Enoch the Just. Nevertheless, despite this new astronomical knowledge, the astronomers and the scholars who studied the heavens firmly believed that the gods created this complex mechanism of the heavens and the stars. They still believed that one could read the stars like heavenly writing, and that observing and recording the movements of the stars, one could then look for similar patterns on Earth, which could then be predicted. So by around 450 BCE, astronomers invented the zodiac, a precise instrument for mapping the heavens. And this also gave rise to the science of zodiac astrology and horoscopes, which eventually replaced all other forms of divination, predicting the future. But what's important for us is to see how these changes played out in the areas of science, in other areas of science, which are also competing with religion. Now, medicine is the most socially relevant of any science, since everyone needs medicine. We can live without advanced mathematics and even astronomy, but everyone needs medicine. And medicine involves an element of belief or faith, either as faith in our doctors or faith in the power of the medicine or faith that God or the gods intend for us to be healed. In reality, there is a lot of magic within medicine. Now, this is certainly true of Assyrian and Babylonian medicine, as well as Egyptian medicine. These systems contain numerous spells and incantations, as well as medical prescriptions and medical recipes. But by 400 BCE, dramatic changes in Babylonian medicine reflected new advances in mathematical astronomy. We see the emergence of a new science, astral science, astral medicine, which combine medicine and astrology. Doctors now wish to apply the new discoveries in astronomy and astrology to their own work with patients. So if the zodiac could accurately predict movement stars, it could be used to predict whether events on Earth would be favorable or unfavorable. So then, perhaps the zodiac could be used to predict whether the same symptoms in a patient might have a good or a bad prognosis. So doctors turned their attention to zodiac signs. Drugs prescribed under favorable zodiac signs might have better results than medicines prescribed under unfavorable zodiac signs. Now, we could call this today applied science, adapting theory to practice. But the importance of this approach shouldn't be judged by our modern standards, whether it's scientifically valid or not, but by the ancient criteria of observing, recording data, and inferring from this data certain patterns. This is what we mean by the dawn of science. But there's a contentious issue within modern studies of ancient Babylonian medicine, and this concerns disease diagnosis, since diseases were often designated by the term hand of a specific god, or the hand of a ghost, similar such expressions. For instance, a text might tell us that if a patient suffered from certain symptoms, he suffered from the hand of Marduk, hand of Ishtar, the hand of Lilith, or even the hand of a ghost. Now, there are two ways of looking this evidence. These expressions describing the causes of disease already existed at the time of Hammurabi of Babylon. And I'm pretty certain that in this early period, the term hand of a ghost, hand of a god, meant just that. It referred to disease symptoms. The patient's disease was brought on by the personal intervention a god, a demon, a ghost. And doctor and patient both would have believed this. But by the middle of the first millennium BCE, 1,000 years later, perceptions changed. The expression hand of a god, hand of a ghost, took on a new meaning, which we see in an important compendium of Babylonian diagnosis known as this Diagnostic Handbook. In this list of some 15,000 symptoms, one section of this text has a very unusual format in the form of a table, several columns. One column lists skin diseases, you see on the right-hand one, by the hand of various Babylonian gods, hand of Gula, hand of Ninurta, hand of Marduk, while the other column defined each of these divine hands with the technical name of a disease, a skin disease. We could translate these as eczema, scabies, or some other skin condition. In other words, the designation, hand of a god, was equated with a technical disease name. Because by this time, the traditional vocabulary of medicine needed more precision in the form of technical medical terminology. But the same expression probably meant different things to different people. So the physician might have told his patient that his symptom was caused by the hand of Marduk, by which he meant that the patient was suffering from Bhikshu disease or Bhushanu disease. But the patient would have concluded that he was being personally punished by the god Marduk for his sins by causing this disease. So the problem for the modern researcher today is to be able to determine which meaning is really intended by in our medical diagnosis. And whether these labels, hand of a god or hand of a ghost or hand of a demon, do they reflect science, religion, or both? Now, to look at this problem, cast more light, it's useful sometimes to look from the outside, so we turn to the Greeks. Open any textbook on the history of ancient science, English or Bulgarian, doesn't matter, and you'll be told that ancient science begins with the Greeks. What's typically not mentioned is that the Babylonians were asking the same kinds of questions and making similar observations at approximately the same time. The difference is that the Babylonians were much better at observing and much worse at writing down theories. But some of these same tensions between science and religion can be found in ancient Greek medicine as well, which is somewhat surprising to historians of medicine. Let's look at Hippocratic medicine. Now, on the surface, Greek medicine looks like science. The Hippocratic corpus prides itself on separating medicine from magic and the workings of magicians and diviners. These are all considered to be quacks and charlatans. And it's true that the Hippocratic corpus, unlike Egyptian and Babylonian medicine, contains no incantations or magical rituals. All this clearly looks like scientific medicine, free of the presence of divine influences or demons or ghosts, and modern historians of medicine judge Greek medicine to be much more scientific than its Oriental counterparts. But there is a somewhat embarrassing side to Greek medicine, which historians often ignore. Galen, certainly the greatest of the Roman physicians, was himself deeply religious. He believed himself to have been healed by the god Asclepius. He would at times prescribe magical amulets to patients, and he even noted that these amulets sometimes seemed to restore patients to good health. For much of his life, Galen lived in the city of Pergamum, which was also the home to one of the great healing temples of the ancient world, the Asclepion, where patients were put to sleep in order to have the god Asclepius appear to them in a dream and tell the patient which medical regime he or she was to follow in order to be healed. Archaeologists have found a large number of votive plaques in the Asclepion attesting to miraculous cures from Asclepius' medicine. Now, the best record we have of such treatments comes from the autobiography of one Aelius Aristides, a famous Roman orator, roughly contemporary with Galen, who was chronically ill and was a confirmed hypochondriac. Aristides was a firm believer in Asclepius and a frequent visitor to the Asclepion, which actually resembled Club Mediterranee more than a religious temple, a religious shrine. Huh? The Pergamon Asclepion, for instance, was equipped with a theater. It had boutiques, it had baths, it had dormitories. Amusements was found in a leafy suburban suburb. All without all this bloody mess of animal sacrifices that you normally have in an ordinary temple. Aristides writes that he intentionally ignored the advice of his Hippocratic doctors with their scientific medicine. He writes that he preferred to follow the advice given to him by the god Asclepius in a dream. So he would bathe in cold ice water to get rid of a fever, and he refused to have his abscess treated by a physician. Now, perhaps Aristides was exceptionally lucky to survive this advice, but his extensive notes on his illnesses and treatments is an impressive testimony to religious belief over scientific theory in this area of medicine. So if we reflect back on our Babylonian example of the hand of a god or the hand of a ghost causing disease, it isn't surprising to find different interpretations of this phrase, either as a technical term for illness or a pious expression of divine interference in human affairs. In any case, advances in mathematical astronomy and academic interest in astronomy was the engine for profound changes in how the cosmos perceived. So although the gods still ruled the universe, mankind was seeking other kinds of non-divine explanations for how the world functioned. And this quest is what we now call science.
Здоровье же и спасение, и во всем благое поспешение, подождь, Господи, благочестивому и православному болгарскому народу, и сохрани